Welcome everyone to the 2023 DoubleLine Infrastructure Income Cast. We titled this webcast, The Road Less Traveled, as we've started to see increasing inquiries on this fund as investors become more concerned about the degradation of macro markets and are seeking an asset class that offers both principal protection and the ability to generate returns through income and capital appreciation. Historically, infrastructure has almost been exclusively in the domain of private markets, but at DoubleLine, we do offer infrastructure debt through liquid and public vehicle. Going back to our previous webcast in July of last year, a few topics that were affecting markets and investor sentiment. Recession fears were still in the preliminary stages. Inflation was heavily impacting markets. And then other macro factors such as geopolitical and climate issues were all being dealt with. We'll start off by looking at some macro markets today. Recession risks became headline news a year ago, but consumer has been resilient. And this has really certainly helped to delay the onset of the recession. Here, we're looking at a number of business and consumer measures. First, let's look at the dotted black line, and that is going to be the average of all of these data sets, and this is trending upwards. So close to one half of one standard deviation above the mean. So that is indicating some confidence amongst the consumer and businesses. But we do see an important component in the economy, the red line. This depicts the small business optimism trending convincingly downward. Close to one standard deviation below its historical mean. Small businesses, large part of the U.S. economy, so we may see some flow-through effects to the broader economy if this persists or perhaps declines even further. Leading economic indicators have found some footing here from the rapid descent that really began in the start of 2022, but both the year-over-year change, and which is the black line, and then the six-month annualized return six-month annualized change in LEI, which is the red line, are at levels seen only during recession. Even if we are stabilizing here, looking at the time series, we never see these levels during expansionary periods. The unemployment rate remains low, but it has been trending upwards, with the latest print coming in at 3.6%. If you look more closely at this chart, I do want to draw your attention to the red line. This is the exponential moving average. When the unemployment rate pierces the moving average, it can be a recessionary signal. You notice that there's been a number of quote-unquote false starts in the past, but we've never seen the unemployment rate rise by one half of a percent from its low without experiencing recession. And so far, with this latest print, we are seeing we're about 0.2% from the low. So this data point is certainly worth keeping an eye on. The pace of rate hikes have caused a deep inversion in the yield curve. And here we're taking a look at the difference between the two-year Treasury rate and the 10-year rate. It's widely acknowledged that the inversion of the curve is a signal for an impending recession, which is true, but the better indicator that recession is nearing has been the re-steepening of the curve once an inversion has been achieved. The red shaded bars here do show previous recessions, and you can see that this certainly has been the pattern historically. I wouldn't call what we're seeing this week or even at the start of the end of last week a steepening just yet, but we are seeing some de-inversion. So yet again, another warning light to pay attention to as we are mindful of a potential recession in the future. Here, we're taking a look at a chart of real GDP forecasts year by year. And by looking at the purple line on the far right, which represents 2023, we did come into the year with growth forecasts near zero, but saw a number of upward revisions that have led expectations for about a 1% growth this year. This has come at the expense of the blue line on the right. And what it's doing is really pushing the expectation of a slowdown in GDP growth into 2024. Core inflation, it's been stubborn, stubbornly slow to fall, but what we do expect is the trend to change towards the second half of this year. Core goods have been coming down again, just reporting yesterday used car sales, or excuse me, prices posted a record decline. And that was the Manheim Index. And we do see this as a tailwind We also do expect shelter prices to fall and OER, which is owner's equivalent rent, to follow suit. This is a pretty significant portion of core inflation, and our expectation is that we will see some progress made towards Fed targets as we go into the remainder of the year. If that is the case, though, it does become difficult to believe the Fed will be able to get an additional 50 basis points of hiking in for the rest of the year. Although at this point, looking at market expectations, 25 basis points in July does seem quite likely. It's not just the Fed that will slow the economy down. Tightening and lending standards are beginning to have an effect already. Here we see the yellow line indicating how stringent lending standards are at banking institutions. The higher the yellow line, the more difficult it is to get the loan. Naturally, as availability of capital becomes scarce, defaults will rise. And you are seeing that the blue line here, which is the corporate default rate, increasing as lending standards tighten. It is our belief that tighter credit conditions could be equivalent to an additional 50 to 100 basis points of Fed hikes, which is another reason the Fed may find it difficult here to implement another two hikes in 2023. This is an interesting chart, and this compares the default rates of infrastructure debt to non-financial corporates through various cycles. The yellow shaded regions are recessionary periods, and we can see that during all recessions, and this goes back to 1999, we've seen fewer defaults within the infrastructure complex. And this is largely due to the critical nature of these assets and the inelastic demand for the services they provide. As we are approaching the possibility of another recession, if this relationship holds up, and we can't really find a reason why it wouldn't, infrastructure should be considered for investor portfolios. Shifting our focus next to energy and energy prices. On this chart, we can see oil's well off its peak in 2022 and bouncing around that low 70s range. I did see it at 73 earlier today. We are tracking China's reopening impact on final oil demand and seeing very aggressive summer travel season going on right now. At the same time, OPEC cuts will be implemented this month and potentially subsequent months. Typically, with a recession or macro weakness, this should dampen oil prices. But our base case is that supply and demand balance may slip into deficit later this year, and that should be supportive of oil prices at these levels. So do see some stability in oil prices in the near future here. For natural gas, very similar story of supportive prices, but for different reasons. Volatility we saw driven by Ukraine situation has subsided. Europe was fortunate that their winter was mild and short, which really helped gas prices fall from their very, very elevated levels. Today, the U.S. is a net exporter of gas. And with demand globally more reliant on non-Russian energy, U.S. exportation of natural gas should help maintain a stable supply and demand dynamic and thus more stable pricing for natural gas. So similar on both oil and nat gas, we do see stability in the new future for both these commodities. Graphically, this chart here depicts the natural gas dynamic here in the United States. Production ramped up post-2005, and as production, which is the purple line here, exceeds domestic demand, which is the blue line on the top, that excess is now being exported and certainly has all but eliminated the need to import energy in that gas form. So you can see that in the green line dropping below that zero horizontal axis. As long as this dynamic holds, we do feel that nat gas prices will have reduced downside volatility on a go-forward basis. Looking next at renewable energy now accounts for about 20% of total U.S. power production. This is expected to grow, and on this chart, we see the three sources of growth within renewables, that's biomass, wind, and solar. We have investments in all three areas. And with technology improving and the utilization of storage, transforming this to an around-the-clock type power source, we continue to see opportunities in this space. Having said that, cleaner traditional power isn't going to be replaced by this technology. We do see both power sources, renewables and cleaner fossil fuel generated power coexisting in the future. With growing power needs, you're going to need grid modernization. And this is one of the larger capital expenditures within the power industries. On this chart here, we see a number of regulatory actions for grid modernization by state. The darker the shade, the more actions that have been requested. And this would include things such as energy storage deployment, utility business model reforms, and smart grid deployment. This isn't a one-way road here where CapEx is being spent and then sources of revenue will be identified later. Regulated utilities have the right to pass through expenses in the form of price adjustments to end users. They have a regulatory right to maintain their profit margins. Not many businesses out there can say the same. We do see these deployments as beneficial for the jurisdictions that they will serve. But also, as these deployments occur, we see this as a compelling source of investments for this infrastructure fund. Looking at the customer base next for power, we can see that residential, commercial, and industrial are all beginning to plateau. But transportation, which is at the bottom line there, hugging that zero horizontal axis, has been essentially hugging that line since this data, as far as this data goes back. We do see transports as a big driver for future growth in the power space. And clearly, as that increases, the need for continued development and reliance on power infrastructure is going to only increase as well. Investments in charging, communication, and data infrastructure also continues to intrigue us as this transportation network continues to evolve. Looking at solar at the residential level here, we're taking a look at growth has been brisk. And while housing turnover or refinancings have resulted in prepayment speeds in the 15% range on an annual basis historically, we're seeing elevated mortgage rates today and also reduced mobility. And with that, we've seen solar prepayments cut to about a third of their historical levels. So significantly slower prepayments on these assets. And as rates remain high, that should be the case for this asset class. At the same time as prepayment speeds are slowing, we are seeing increased annualized losses within this residential solar universe. It'd be justified for anyone to be concerned that prepayment speeds are slow and loss rates are going up, but loss rates remain low. And I'll have to remind our listeners here that the positions that we own in this fund are very well insulated against losses. The average position is able to withstand more than 25% losses before seeing even a dollar principal loss. Historically, the highest that we've seen losses within the solar space has been about 4%. Currently, the universe is at 2.2. So still very low levels, but the positions that we own can take substantial losses before we're impacted at all. Next, looking at data center and telecom infrastructure, we are seeing a lot of growth in this area. Transactions secured by network infrastructure has been really prolific during the first half of this year, and the demand for data is only increasing. And we expect this issuance to continue to fund this. One thing that isn't as well appreciated in this space is the amount of power required to operate this infrastructure. On the charts here, we can see that growth in power consumption within the space is closely tied to power and telecom infrastructure. And we see the ecosystems with power and data telecom to be closely integrated and both to grow in the future here. As with many areas of infrastructure, the ability to pass through rising costs to end consumers does give infra the ability to insulate against inflation. Here, we're looking at rental rates for data centers. Rental rates were consistently falling going into 2020, and this is because more capacity was coming online, and then technological advances improved efficiency. But as power prices rose post-2021, operators in the space were able to pass through increased cost to end users. So really what we saw in this space is as power costs rose, and that's the biggest input costs for this sector, we really didn't see any fall off in revenue here, which is definitely a very big plus for this area. We're taking a look at the transportation sector, and we see global airline revenue segmented by both passenger and cargo. What's notable here is that in 2023, we're almost back to pre-pandemic levels with revenue. If you've traveled recently, you'll know that airplanes are fully booked, and many other infrastructure sectors, airlines have been able to pass through higher input costs, whether it's due to labor or fuel, onto the travelers. Revenue has been very strong, and we do expect to see that reflected in third quarter earnings with such a strong summer season that we're currently experiencing right now. Finally, looking a little closer at just air cargo versus maritime shipping, with airlines seeing such strong passenger demand and really high utilization across the board, costs are at pre-COVID highs. While the opposite has really been occurring with maritime shipping, demand for durable goods has been declining, and this has been alleviating the bottlenecks within the maritime supply chain. And despite this increasing competitiveness of maritime freight rates, we're not very constructive here, and have found other sectors of infrastructure much more intriguing, actually have been legging out of some of these assets in favor of other sectors of infrastructure. A number of questions have come through the queue. The one area that we may continue to migrate out of here is transportation. That's heavily cyclical. As the economy slows down, certainly could see decreases in utilization and volume and therefore revenue in those spaces. So have been migrating out already, but potentially could see a little bit more migration in that space. A question on global shipping, that has been a sector that, you know, has performed quite well through COVID, especially the positions that we held that were secured, that were amortizing and paying both principal and interest. But as spreads come in and we do potentially see utilization rates decrease in that area, we have been migrating out. So hopefully that answers the question. We're essentially almost out of completely of that sector. And then one macro question I'll just answer here, and it seems like we're going to be at the top of the hour, so we'll just conclude it with this question. It's a longer question, but I'll just summarize it. It's really asking about QT and slowing of the economy and potentiality of rising rates and how, you know, investors in fixed income should expect to fare in that type of situation. Now, I would say this, as bond fund managers, we have a number of levers at our disposal in order to mitigate risk and maximize return. At the highest level, we talked about duration a bit. And if the expectation is that rates will rise, certainly can take an active effort to reduce your duration, and that will minimize the impact of rising rates on the portfolio. As a secondary basis, we do utilize securitized investments, and these are investments that are not only secured by the underlying assets and essentially privy to all the cash flow coming off those assets, but they also amortize and pay principal and interest along the way. So into a rising rate environment, if you do have assets paying both principal and interest, that is a good thing because you can take the principal pay downs that are coming in and redeploy it into higher yielding assets. So I do think that even if we do see higher interest rates here, the opportunities that we're seeing in fixed income, including infrastructure related fixed income, is some of the best that we've seen certainly in my entire career. So are very optimistic. We are very optimistic here about fixed income returns and also what we can provide our investors on a go-forward basis. With that, I'll just conclude the call here. Certainly appreciate everyone's time and support. And until next time, hope everyone stays well. Thank you very much.